Good morning. Happy Easter to everyone. Welcome to Elkhart Life Online. We're so excited that you joined us this morning. Easter morning, we're normally here in church. We're in the best outfit that we can possibly purchase, and we want to look as great as we can for the celebration of our risen King. It's a special day. We're going to be doing communion at home. We're excited about that. That's something that we've never done before, and it truly is taking the church into the home. I just want to read a scripture before I go in this morning. Matthew 28, 1. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn towards the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sculptor. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning. His raiment was white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and become as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the woman, "Fear not, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come and see the place where the Lord lay." We don't serve a dead, dry God. We serve a risen King. Prophesied in the Old Testament, come through into the New Testament. He's not a dead, dry God. He's a living God. He died that I might live again. We get to celebrate the great rising of the King of Kings and the El Shaddai. So I'm going to ask that you stand across your living room. You raise your hands right now. God, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for taking the lashes on the back for us, God. Thank you for taking that crown of thorns, God. Lord, thank you for dying on a cross that I may live again, God. Lord, you defeated death, hell, and the grave, God. Thank you for all of these things, God, that I can celebrate and live again in your spirit, God. I praise you, Lord, and I worship you, God. Lord, this is the day that we celebrate, God. Lord, for all the things that you've done for us, God. Lord, for fulfilling the prophecy laid before, God. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. We praise your name, God. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Lord. I can only say that I wish you were in this building with us right now, because there's an incredible presence of God in this building. And I know that you're home on your couch, but I'm going to ask you to just raise your hands again in Jesus' name. God, I thank you, Lord. Koyo lo 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 si, baba yo lo si ata ta. Koyo lo 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 si, ala la la. Baba yo lo lo si, ala la la. Baba lo si ata ta. In Jesus' name. God, I pray. I was talking to Brother Mass this week as we were delivering communion bags. And we began to speak about the peace of God that's fall upon us and our families. If you've been out in a store, if you still work a job, there's a lot of fear right now. There's a lot of uncertainty. I told my wife I felt like I was walking on eggshells all week this week, because anything that you could say or do would upset or offend somebody, because everybody is afraid, except for the people that have a relationship with God. There's a few ladies in my office, and they're great Christians, and they're not afraid. They're not worrisome. But anyone who doesn't have a relationship with God, anyone that doesn't know, they're just on edge, and the littlest thing can set them off. I feel like I've said it every single week that I've got behind this pulpit. This is our opportunity to be the peacemaker in our homes, the peacemaker in our jobs, to be the lighthouse into a dark world, to show everyone that there's no reason to fear, because God is not the author of fear nor confusion. So before we go into worship, just one more time, let's just thank God for being that peacemaker in our life. In Jesus' name, God, I thank you, Lord. Thank you for all the opportunities that we have to allow your presence to shine through us, God. To allow your anointing to be placed upon us, God. And allowing us to speak words of wisdom and Christ's power into people's lives, God. We pray, Lord, that you continue to move forth and through this service today. God, that you anoint our worship team, that you anoint Brother Johnson, God. We thank you for this opportunity to celebrate with you today. In Jesus' name.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Our God saves.
Our God saves.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Highest praises.
Highest praises.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
We give thanks.
I'm grateful for who you are and all you've done. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Oh, my soul cries hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Hallelujah. Lord, we lift you up, Jesus. We praise you and we glorify you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Our God saves.
Our God saves.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Highest praises.
Highest praises.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. For who you are and all you've done. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Oh, my soul cries hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Oh, my soul cries hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Hallelujah. Lord, you've saved us. You've resurrected, Lord, and we give you glory and praise for that, Jesus. Lord, we thank you for salvation and restoration, God. I give you praise. Hallelujah. Lord, I worship you. I praise you. I glorify you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for your peace. I thank you, Lord, for your comfort. I thank you, Lord, for your joy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, I praise you, Jesus.
You've been so good, you've been so good. I thank you, Lord, I thank you. My heart is full, my heart is full. I love you, Lord, I love you. You've been so good, you've been so good. I Hi. every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You have the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome.
At the cross your work was finished. You were buried in the grass, but the grave could not contain you, for you wear the victor's crown.
Hallelujah. You have overcome. You have overcome. Hallelujah. Jesus, you have overcome. The world,
every high thing must come down.
Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome, you overcome. Have overcome. You have overcome. Hallelujah. Jesus, you have overcome the world.
Oh, the blood of Jesus, oh, the blood of Jesus, oh, the blood of Jesus, it washes white as snow. Say, oh, the blood of Jesus, oh, the blood of Jesus, oh, the blood of Jesus, it washes white as snow.
There is healing, there is healing in the blood of Jesus. There is healing in the blood of Jesus. There is healing in the blood of Jesus. For it washes white as snow.
There is peace.
There is peace in the blood of Jesus. There is peace in the blood of Jesus. There is peace in the blood of
You join us one more time. Let's just sing that chorus. Amen. One more time. Come on and sing.
Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus.
Let's worship the Lord together. God, we praise you. Amen. God, we praise you. We thank you, Lord, for the blood. We thank you, Lord, for your precious, amen, precious blood. Thank you for joining with us today during our Easter celebration service. It's an honor to have you joining with us. Everybody is streaming this. There's very few people except our technical folks in the auditorium. And so we're going to celebrate Easter a little differently. And thank you for tuning in to be with us for this Easter service. Today we celebrate the resurrection. Friday came, the death on the cross, the burial. But after Friday, Sunday always shows up. And so we're here on a Sunday to magnify the Lord together. We felt a great spirit of the Lord as the choir and the praise team were worshiping together. And we felt a great presence when we were praying early before service started. And I pray that you'll feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost as we look at the Word of God today and try to understand something out of the Word of God that we can apply into our life. I'm going to read from 1 Peter chapter 1. Verse 18, amen. 1 Peter 1, verse 18 through verse 22 says, "For as much as you know that you are not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who by him do believe in God, that raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might be in God, seeing how you purified your souls and obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren. See that you love one another with a pure heart fervently." Amen. That's a beautiful combination of words in that scripture, linking the very foundation of the world, the very development and plan of God and the purpose of God that was expressed in the man Jesus Christ, who was God manifest in the flesh. And that man gave his life to pay the price for our sins. Although innocent, he was chosen to be guilty, and he was chosen to be guilty for my guilt, not for his guilt, not for anything that he had done, but for what I and you have done in our own lives, the mistakes we've made, the sins we've committed. What a great, great thing, amen, a great gift that is to you and I. Philippians says, chapter 2, verse 6 through verse 8, who, though he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. You can't have Sunday without Friday, but if you have a Friday, Sunday comes. Amen. Let's talk about the power of resurrection and the power of transformation as we look at the Word of God today. Pray with me, would you? Amen. His Spirit would join with us. God, we thank you for an opportunity to gather in your presence with your people, although at a distance. Amen. God, you draw us close. For we're one body and one purpose, amen, to magnify you, to celebrate your sacrifice, amen, and to rejoice in your resurrection. God, I thank you for your presence that we feel, amen, the anointing that you give us to speak in and to and through us. Anoint our hearts and our ears to hear, not what says Mark Johnson, but what says the Spirit of the Lord today. I pray, amen, that your anointing would be upon us to bring your purpose. We trust you for that in Jesus' great name. Christian transformation, define that. It is an inward renewal and reshaping of the mind through which a Christian's inner person is changed into the likeness of Christ. Our purpose literally is that we will be changed in his image on this earth. And that process begins with our faith in Christ, that we start a transformational process. The regeneration of the cross, the regeneration of our faith in the cross begins immediately. We begin to allow things in our life as we repent and turn from our old way and seek to be born a new creature in Christ. Amen. Old things pass away, the Word of God says. All things become new. And so there is a regeneration that begins when you believe, when you take that first step of faith. God, I'm going to try to understand. I'm going to try to believe. I'm going to try to follow you. There is a change that happens, but it's not a full completion, a full transformation that God is done, that he's final with. He literally wants us to have an ongoing transformation, that our spirit, amen, will be impacted and changed and developed, and our relationship with him will grow deeper and higher and stronger, and our faith in Christ will develop into a deep, abiding trust in God, that we could trust him, that he knows who we are, knows where we're at, knows what we're going through, and he has our best purposes at heart. Abraham said, "Will not the judge of all the earth do right?" When God and he were meeting and the men were headed into Sodom and Gomorrah, the angels that had come with the angel of the Lord were headed away into Sodom and Gomorrah. He had a conversation with God and he said, "Will not the judge of all the earth do right?" I believe that's the God that we serve today, both you and I, the God of all the earth who does right. He is righteous. He is holy. And every decision he makes is right and holy. Sometimes the decisions I make are influenced by my own flesh or by my selfishness or by some other purpose, some anger or bitterness or frustration. But he does not make those kinds of decisions. He counsels after his own heart, and his own heart is holy and pure, and so he makes right decisions. And one of his purposes prison coming is so that he could transform us, that we could be made new creatures in Christ and let some old things pass away. Hear me as I tell you today, a resurrected Savior represents the ultimate in transformation. He walked on the earth. He served mankind. He healed. He preached the gospel. And then he was condemned for that. And he was offered as a perfect sacrifice, a perfect lamb for my imperfections. His cleanliness, amen, is applied to my uncleanness, his holiness to my unholiness. Hear me. Romans chapter 12 and verse 2 says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That was written to the church in Rome. And the principle is that they needed a continuing transformation of their mind, a continual renewing of your mind. So to the saint of God who's been a member of church for many years, it's still incumbent upon us to deepen our relationship, to put our roots deeper into the Word of God and allow His Spirit to continually transform our heart and mind. For we are to be made in His image, and I haven't achieved that. I don't think that you would say that you've achieved that. The Word of God says in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians verse 3 and verse 18, this translation is a word-for-word translation from the Greek. It's not something you find in the King James. It's more literal translation. And it says, we all with unveiled face, mirroring the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another, even as from the Lord who is the Spirit. That for a moment, that He has taken us and He is regenerating us. He is transforming us. And we see His unveiled face. You think in the Old Testament, several times some of the ancient men of God asked, I want to see your face. Let me see you. God, I want to know your name. Tell me your name. And they just wanted to know more about God than they knew in the moment. And they were trying to develop a closer understanding, a deeper relationship with God, trying to know who He was. I'm praying, amen, that you have that same spirit inside of you that says, God, I want to draw closer to you. I want my spirit to be closer to your spirit. I want my heart to be closer to your heart. I want my thinking to be closer to your thinking. I want to know you in the power of your resurrection. I want to know who you are. I want to know your character. I want to know your holiness. I want to know your righteousness, and not from a vague, distant manner. But God, I want to know you in order to trust you, in order to believe you, amen, in order to hear your voice and hear the leading of the power of your spirit. You really can't think that there is no transformation possible. Sometimes I've talked with individuals and they have a fear, uncertainty that God will transform them, that God wants to transform them, that He could transform them. I want you to think about this. A caterpillar has no clue, I don't think, that it's going to be a butterfly. It just lives its life eating leaves day by day by day until all of a sudden it feels some deep urge to be transformed. Finds a limb, finds a branch, attaches itself, weaves itself a cocoon, and then settles into that for a period of time, waiting on the spring to come. And when the day comes, the proper time arrives, it begins to break out of that shell, and it is no longer a caterpillar. It truly becomes a butterfly, and it lives a completely different life than it ever lived before. Those that talk about, well, nature just happens to develop its own processes. How did the first caterpillar say, I'm going to be a butterfly. How did it say I'm going to develop the idea of a cocoon? And I think maybe just randomly, I'll make a cocoon and let's just see what happens. And then he appears months later and says, wow, what a great idea Mother Nature had. Mother Nature came up with this plan, and here I am, a butterfly. I'm telling you, I believe it was the purpose and the plan of God, amen, to create a butterfly out of a caterpillar and do it through a process of metamorphosis that he created, a plan and purpose of God. And if we can believe that something can be transformed in nature, then we ought to understand that we can be transformed. Amen. We can be a new creature in Christ. We can have a transformation happen in our lives, that God could take us from what we were born in and make us something we weren't born into. Amen. But we get reborn into. That transformation is miraculous. If you think about it, you think about an example I use often in funerals. The grub becomes a dragonfly. When a grub is born, a little small wormy looking thing, it lives underneath the water and it spends its whole life underneath the water, getting oxygen through its skin and living there, eating there. The whole life cycle of a grub is underneath the water. But at some point, he connects to a lily pad or something and goes through his own metamorphosis, his own transformation. And when he emerges not as a grub, but he emerges as a dragonfly. And he emerges not as living in the water, but living in the air. He's a completely transformed. Everything about his life is different. He can no longer go back under the water and live. He's designed to live above the water. And so, my dear friend, are you. You're designed, if you've ever been born again, you're designed to live where God calls you to be, where he called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light. And he never intended anybody to ever go back into the darkness again. Hear me as I preach to you. If you're born into the Spirit, if you're born into the presence of God, then God intends for you to live there. No matter what happens in your life, no matter what mistakes you made, no matter what difficulties you face, no matter how many people have ever disappointed you, no matter what preacher, what person on the pew, what friend or old buddy, amen, disappoints you, you have been designed by God to be transformed and live above your old life. You're intended to fly into the sky, not swim under the water and the weight of sin. You can't, and don't come up with excuses. Don't come up with reasons. Don't blame other people. Don't blame other things. Amen. Don't say, well, I would have, because someday you're going to stand in front of God and it's not going to be good enough. God, I would have really lived for you, but Fred was mean to me, or Sue didn't shake my hand, or somebody didn't do something right. They backed into my car in the church parking lot. The preacher was too loud or too short. Something happened that I didn't like, and so I got out of the boat and went back to my old life and went underwater, under the water of sin. God never designed you to live under the water of sin. He designed you to fly in the Spirit and have his Spirit flowing out of your life. Out of your belly would flow rivers of living water, the Word of God says. 1 John 3:2 says, we can't even imagine what we will be like when Christ returns. But we do know that when he comes, we will be like him. Amen. For we shall see him as he really is. In our building, we have stained glass windows, and you can look through them, but they're modeled, and they're got a pattern to them that you can look through it, and you may be able to see a car drive by, but you can't tell what kind of car. You might be able to tell it's a truck or a car or a person walking by, but most likely you won't know who it is unless you recognize the clothing they have on, the color patterns maybe, but it'd be very hard to recognize somebody through the glass that's in this building because of its pattern. And the Bible says, today we look through a glass darkly. And I would say, you that are listening to me, you look through a glass darkly. You need to understand that. You don't know who holds or what's going on tomorrow. You don't know the difficulty that you're going to face or the triumph that you're going to achieve. You don't know what the stock market's going to do. We see through a glass darkly. But the enemy tries to do one thing. He tries to get us to disbelieve our future, disbelieve the promises of God, disbelieve, amen, the commitment that God has to keep you and to keep you safe and to walk with you and walk beside you and lift you up and encourage you and strengthen you for the journey. He said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. Amen. He is going to be on your side. Amen. He is going to be with you until he's done. Amen. Until you're transformed and you get to be like him. For you see him not through just the preacher's words, not just through the words that you read in Scripture, but you see him as he is. What a great day that will be. Amen. And that transformation that happens in nature is a transformation, I believe, that's going to happen in the spirit. But we don't have to wait till the end till we're transformed into his image. He is doing that transformational process today, now. Amen. He came, he gave himself, he died, he was sacrificed, he suffered nails in his hand, nails in his feet, a crown of thorns, beating on his back, stripes, blood, a stabbing that opened up his heart and out forth poured blood and water. It was a emblem of his suffering. It was an emblem of his pain, his emotional pain, as he died on the cross, rejected by the very ones he created, rejected by the people that he loved, the people that he said, I'm going to put my name there. They rejected him along with the Roman government. It's not just one society, but mankind rejected him. Nobody stood up that day. Nobody said, don't do this. Nobody said, let's not execute him. Everybody stood by. If they didn't agree, they didn't even speak up. They were silent on that day. But he did it because he spent some time in the garden saying, God, don't let me drink this cup. God, don't let me drink this cup. Let this cup pass from me. It was such an agonizing prayer. The Word of God says he sweat, as it were, great drops of blood as he cried out to God. But he kept coming back and saying, nevertheless, not my will, but thy be done. Not the will of my flesh, not the will of my humanity, but the will of divinity, the will of your purpose, God. The will that you want to accomplish is greater than me as an individual. Hear me as I preach to you. God's purpose for your life is greater than your purpose can ever be. He has a greater design and a greater plan and can accomplish more with you serving him than you'll ever be able to accomplish on your own. Allow the Holy Ghost to transform you. Come on, somebody believe me here today that God can, that God wants to transform you, make you a new creature, wash away sins, give you a new heart and a new mind. Amen. And the Bible says it's the transforming or the renewing of your mind. And he wants to start that process wherever you are, dear child of God. Amen. Whoever, if you're away from God, if you're at a distance, you're not worshiping, you're not following, you know of God, but you're not in a close relationship with God. I'm preaching to you. Amen. God is calling you. God is reaching for you. Amen. He has your name on his mind. He's got you in his heart. He wants you to be saved. He wants you to come back to where you belong, to live and walk in his presence, to serve and worship him, to know the God of gods. Who could have a greater call than that? Who could say something greater than the God of gods, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, wants a relationship with you, a transformational relationship with you. He wants to show you. He wants to teach you. He wants to develop you. He wants to raise you as a father does a child. Amen. Because he loves you. Say, well, I don't know that God loves me. Yes, you do. The Word of God says very clearly, he loves you enough. He died for you. He paid the ultimate price so you wouldn't have to suffer and you wouldn't have to die if you'd follow him. 1 Corinthians 15:52 says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal put on immortality. What great hope those words are. That at the end, amen, some people are going to die and be dead. But we're going to die and be transformed. We're going to die and live forever. Amen. If he comes back while we're alive, he's going to catch us up. And we shall be forever with the Lord. What great hope that is. What a great transformation. But he's not waiting till then. Amen. There's a scripture that says, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's what I'm calling you to. I'm calling you not to float, not to just sit back with a paddle on your lap waiting for God to come and do something and make you live for him. He's asking us to press toward the mark. I'm listening to a very interesting book about the 1936 Olympics and the American teams went over to Germany, and they saw all the things that Hitler had done to try and show how wonderful Nazism was. And yet there was a seed behind that that certainly was extremely evil, but he tried to hide that from the eyes of the world. And yet they worked and they worked and they had labored for years. Their college juniors who had been working for years to learn how to row, together, to work day and night and in the winter and in the wind and all the difficulties that they could face on open waters in Washington State. They faced those and got better and better and better. And finally, they made it to the Olympics. I don't know about you, but if you can imagine heaven as the Olympics, I don't think you can work your way to get there. Don't anybody misunderstand what I'm saying. But the Word of God calls us to press towards the mark. Amen. To be transformed, to grow in his likeness, to see him as he is. What a pull the Spirit has to you and I, amen, to draw us into relationship. Paul cried out, oh, that I might know him in the power of his resurrection. That's what I want to know. I want to know in the power of his resurrection. I want to know in the power of his transformation. Amen. That he went into the grave, just a man, just a body, with the Spirit leaving the body. And then when he was born again on the third day, he was raised. The Spirit moved back into the body and the dead came to life. There was a transformation that happened there. And I believe God continually transforms you and I. Yes. If we believe, if we'll trust and allow him to do exactly that. Would you bow your head with me? I'm going to ask us to pray together. I don't know what you're facing and what the Word of God has spoken to you. I find that the Word of God often speaks to individuals differently according to what's going on in your life and what God's been trying to talk to you about. I want you to hear me. I do believe it's not just my voice you hear. I do believe in the room that the Spirit of God speaks into the deep places of our heart and that you can hear God call. You know, I'm talking to you, that God's calling you out of complacency. God's calling you out of your own humanity. God's calling you out of satisfying just yourself to press toward the mark, to satisfy him, to have a relationship with him. Come on, let's pray together, would you? Amen. Open your heart. God, speak into my life. Come on, let's pray. God, I thank you for the precious, precious word of God. I believe, God, that your spirit calls to us, that you reach to us. Amen. God, you want us in the fold, in your presence, growing under your tutelage, God, under your gentle guiding hand, drawing us up, drawing us higher. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, not by my mind, not by my power, God, but by your sweet spirit. You want us to know you, to hear the sound of your voice, to recognize the sound of your voice. Like sheep do a good shepherd that lives with them. Amen. We can learn to know, God, that you're speaking into our life through time and prayer and relationship. I pray, God, that somebody would start that journey today. I pray, God, they would say, God, I want to know you. I want to know you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I thank you for that. Amen.
Lord,
we trust you.
Take me back to the old landmark where I'll make a new commitment and begin a fresh start. Place a burden in my heart. Lord, take me back.
Praise
to
God.
The old landmark.
Amen. Amen. Allow the Spirit of God to do a work. If you've never been baptized in the name of the Lord, well, the church is open. We'll be happy to baptize you, to wash away your old man. Amen. Allow the process that God laid out in Scripture for us to repent and be baptized in his name and be filled with his presence. And that process can start. If it hasn't already, amen. If you've walked away for some reason, he's calling you back. Yes. Amen. He intends to do his purpose, fulfill his purpose in your life. Amen. I've mentioned to the church that we were going to take today, and as being apart, we wanted to be together. And so I've thought that we could join together in the Spirit of the Lord in communion. We've given to everybody in our church these little communion cups. If you've never done this before, you have a little clear plastic cover that covers the wafer, and you gotta carefully peel that back, trying not to open it too much and spill the contents of the cup. So you open it up, peel it back. And you can go ahead and take out the wafer. I'm going to read some scripture. Then you peel back the cellophane and reveal the juice, the grape juice inside. This has great value. You'll see as we read the Word of God, every time we do this, we do it in remembrance of him, and we do it as a memorial for the sacrifice that he gave. He instituted this. Jesus instituted this before his crucifixion, and he told his disciples, which I am one, to do this and remember him. 1 Corinthians 11 verse 26 says, "For often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink the cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty the body and blood of the Lord, but let a man examine himself. And we've been doing that this week, asking the Lord to do a cleansing in us as we've walked through his death, burial, resurrection this week. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 16 says, the cup of blessing which we bless is not the communion of the blood of Christ. The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we being many are one bread and one body, for we are all partakers of that one bread. Amen. And so we're gathered here in unity, bound together by the blood of Christ, the body of Christ. Verse 23 says, for I have received of the Lord that which also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. If you would, take the bread. Amen. Take it. It's a solemn moment. Verse 25 says, after the same manner also, he took the cup. And when he had supped, saying, this cup is a new testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Amen. Take the wine or the juice until he comes. Amen. Amen. Let's take a minute. Thank the Lord. God, I thank you, Lord, for your great grace. I thank you for your abundant, overwhelming mercy. I pray, God, that your spirit would move. Amen. In and through me. God, cleanse me. Cleanse my heart and mind. Let my mind be stayed on you. God, I pray in the name of the Lord. In the name of the Lord. Because hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, I thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice. I thank you, Lord, for the gift of your life given freely to me and all that are here. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Would you join us? Would you join us? Amen. And sing.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone, because I know he holds the future, and my life is worth the living just because he lives.
God, I praise you. Sing it with me one more time.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he
because he lives. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. Next year, we'll celebrate this together. Hopefully, in May, we'll be celebrating together. We need to remember those that are serving as barriers between us and the pandemic. The doctors and the nurses, the staff at the hospital, the emergency personnel, first responders, paramedics, police, fire, all those different individuals, the president of our country, the governor of our state, the mayors of our local communities, amen. All those individuals are trying to make good decisions and the best decisions with the best information that they have. We need to pray for them, that the Lord would strengthen and give them wisdom, that we would have peace, the peace of God, which passes all understanding, would inhabit our hearts and minds. Maybe this pause that we've got would be a pregnant pause, like a caterpillar going into a cocoon and comes out transformed, much more beautiful. Maybe we can enter into this time and think about this as a time to be transformed, to develop and grow and expand and become more of what God has called us to be. Pray for the preachers. If you're not a member of our church, pray for your pastor. If you don't have a pastor, you need a pastor. You ought to find a pastor. Put a pastor in your life. God has given the ministry, the fivefold ministry, for your benefit and to help you and teach you and train you and grow you. And you need that as much as you may not think you do. You need that in your life. You need all the different aspects of ministry, and you need to be involved in ministry. And God needs to pour something out of you into other people's lives. And you've got to be full up so you can overflow into other people's lives. So those things are the purpose and the desire of God to accomplish in our lives. Amen. So we pray for preachers. We pray for our congregation that the Lord would help us. Amen. As we close, would you pray one more time with me? Yeah, we believe in prayer that the Lord would do exactly that for all of those leaders in our lives. Let's pray together one more time. God, as we close, we thank you for this beautiful day, beautiful presence of God. I pray for those in leadership, in government leadership, our president, our governor, our mayors, God, those in our county that are trying to lead and guide us, protect us, the leaders in the school systems around us. God, give them wisdom and understanding, I pray. I pray, God, that somehow during this time of cloistering and closing ourselves in, that we would be transformed. God, that we would revalue the things that are important and hold family high and our relationships high, our church high, God. Pray for preachers, God, anointed men of God that are calling out to you, that are reaching to you. I pray, God, you would anoint them with wisdom and understanding. Let your word be burning in their hearts, God. Help us to reach our world, to be a light in a dark world. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, let our light shine. We trust you for that. In Jesus' great name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you and thank you for joining with us today. We look forward to being with you again tomorrow morning for a short service as an encouraging word is sent to everybody. God bless you. You're dismissed. Amen. Turn around and shake somebody's hand in your home. Hug their neck. Tell them you love them. You know how we do it at church. God bless you.